Hello, my lovelies, and welcome to a deep dive edition of Writing Expressions with Hashi. It's a working title. But this video is a counterpart to my Dune Holtzman Shield template video, which was also released today. The link is in the description, and it's very digestible and helpful. It gets you the template right away, and you can get started. But if you're here because you saw that video already and are super excited to learn about expressions, expression controls, linking, the pseudo effects builder, then boy, I will talk about those things. In short, I saw the Dune trailer, liked this shield effect, and then built a template that I could share with people to simulate this kind of echoey digital glitch kind of effect. And it works pretty simply. It's pretty straightforward, has a little controller layer at the top where you can adjust a bunch of things. It's laid out kind of fun. But how do you make something like this? Today I really wanted to show you the process one step at a time. So if you find yourself in the position of needing to accomplish a lot of shots and could really benefit from a template, this tutorial is for you. We're specifically going to tackle this shield look, but this kind of workflow could be used for any repeated effect that you do in After Effects that you would like some control over. So with that, buckle up. We're gonna get expression-y. First, it's important to look at the effect we're trying to create and kind of break it down into its core components. Here's a frame from the movie with the effect. And as you can see, it's basically several offset copies of the character, screen transferred and blurred slightly. Now, if I take a frame without the effect, I can copy the look of the effect pretty simply like this. I duplicate the layer, set it to screen transfer mode, and then offsetting it a little bit, I can adjust the levels and make it so the background is effectively filtered out and just the highlights are being seen and screen transferred. Now if I add a CC toner effect, setting the color to a light, dull blue, and maybe add a fast box blur, we're close on the look of one of those echoes. Now all I have to do is draw a mask to keep just the part of footage that corresponds to the body, and then duplicate that layer a few more times and offset them all a bit. Now this definitely passes for the effect on this frame. Now I'll point out something important that they're doing here. The characters have lighting and costume combinations that make them brighter than the background for the most part. This allows for screen transfers of their image to appear nicely and with some color information in front of the background behind them. Now, if the characters appear darker than the background, you run into that classic lightsaber compositing issue, where a screen transfer over a light background washes out the color and definition of your glowing thing, whether it's a lightsaber or a laser blast or fire, something like that. Now, back to this image, we're in the ballpark, but this is just one frame. The actual playback of the movie has lots of cool glitching and impact reactions, and they work in concert with the fight. And that would require some wiggle expressions to probably make them flicker and move kind of chaotically. I mean, you could do this manually, adding something like, you know, wiggle 20 times per second by, say, 25 pixels to the position, wiggle the opacity 10 times per second, by maybe 50%. Now with this layer selected, if I tap E twice, it'll reveal my expressions. I can then highlight the position and opacity while pressing Shift, and then I can right click and say Copy Expressions Only. Then if I select my other two layers, I can paste this same wiggle expression to their position and opacity. And when I play back, we've got a digital glitch that's pretty good. This may work for the, you know, maximum glitchy effect, but as you can see in these clips, it actually only appears in short bursts, and the copy echoes often stay arranged in sort of a linear fashion, often influenced by the direction of the impact of the hit. Now, there are a couple things you could do to make that happen, and lots of keyframing, but honestly right now, you're starting to create a solution that doesn't scale. Likely, there's not just one hit in your fight sequence, there are lots. Now, knowing all this makes me know that I need more control over this effect. And one way to control multiple properties that should be related is to use expression linking, or a control layer. Now, you're probably familiar, but if not, let me introduce you to expression controls. They're a series of filters in After Effects that by themselves don't do anything, but you'll recognize each of them as a way that you interact with an After Effects value in general. Sliders, angle controls, color pickers, 2D and 3D points. To keep it simple, let's just focus on one of these echoes. Let's start with one of the most common of all controllers, adjustable wiggle controls. No one loves the wiggles more than I do, and man is it helpful to be able to control wiggle amounts. My method is usually to create a null object and rename it as a controller. Then I add some of those expression controls to it. In this case, two slider controls. Like any effects in AE, you can rename them here in the effects panel to clarify what you're doing. I'll call the first one flicker amount and the other flicker rate. Then I'll go down to my timeline window and twirl down my slider controls so they're visible here for linking. Now I'll click on my echo layer and reveal its transparency by hitting T, or opacity, I mean. You'll remember that this layer already has an expression on it. I can edit this statement by highlighting the wiggle rate and then clicking on the expression pick whip and dragging it up to this slider, which replaces the wiggle rate in the expression. Now I select the amount and use that pick whip again to override it with the wiggle amount slider. If I solo this layer and press play, you'll see that there's no flicker at all right now. But if I go to my control layer and match the flicker rate and amount from what I previously had in my expression, I now have that same flicker back. What's fun about this is that now I have two slider controls to dial in the look of my flicker. If it's too fast, I can turn the rate down. If it's too wide of a wiggle, I can turn down the amount. I can also set keyframes on the amount, so the flicker is more intense for a while and then less intense later. I wouldn't recommend setting keyframes for the flicker rate, because you'll get some wonky, unexpected results. Why?
A good question for another time.
So now we have control of our wiggle flicker. Now let's add another slider to our control layer. I'll rename this one opacity, and then I'll set its value to 100. Now I can edit the expression on my echo like so. I'll place the cursor before my wiggle expression, and then I'll pick whip the opacity value from my control layer. Then I'll type 1 period to separate these values. This line means that the input number is coming from my slider, and then it's wiggled the same amount as before. Now, with all these links in the expression bar, it's a little bit messy, which is fine. It works, and if you're working quickly, you're already done. Or we could take a little bit more time and make it just a bit more tidy. Instead of this long expression, I could substitute variables for these and make it much more clear what the expression's doing at a glance. Let's deconstruct this a bit. I'll expand my expression window so I have some room to work. And wherever I'm using a pick whipped value, I could actually assign a variable instead. Let's go very basic. A equals the opacity slider amount, B equals the wiggle rate, and C equals the wiggle amount. A little semicolon after each allows me to format this nicely and keep AE happy. And now on this last line here, I can enter my equation as A dot wiggle B by C. It's pretty, right? It doesn't take that much longer to define variables, and it certainly makes expressions cleaner, especially if you're sharing the project file with somebody else. A couple of quick previews, and you can see that now these three sliders in the controller layer are adjusting the total brightness and flicker all in one place. If I were to duplicate my echo layer and offset it a few times, I've got three layers nicely controlled, but each with their own unique random seed. Now, one drawback that's always present when you add a wiggle expression to opacity is that if you're opacity slider is set to zero, that wiggle expression could still raise your opacity a bit, and it's kind of annoying that it doesn't treat zero like zero. Now, you could always keyframe the wiggle amount down to zero each time you key down the opacity to zero, but that seems annoying to have to do. So let's add a kill switch if our slider is set to zero. It's kind of fun, and we get to use a fancy expression. Since these effect control sliders in After Effects are not constrained, I can get values higher than 100 and less than 0 even on this opacity control slider. So for that reason, I want to tell After Effects that if this slider value is less than or equal to 0, then I want the opacity of this layer to be 0, just totally 0 no matter what. Now I'll construct a basic if-else statement. Now, ever since After Effects CC 2018 or so, if-else statements are formatted like this. If this happens, do this. Or else, do this instead. Now, in this case, if A is less than or equal to 0, then the result should just be 0. Or else, it should be a.wiggle b by c. And see, that wasn't so bad. And now you're a super advanced hacker, like me and Angelina Jolie. All right, now as promised, when the slider is set to 0, the flicker is automatically zeroed out as well. So we've gotten control of our opacity and our flicker. Now let's get control over our echo's positions. I want to be able to create a custom offset direction and amount. And I also want to be able to control an additional amount of wiggle after that. That means I'll need an angle control and another slider, and we'll call this the echo direction and this the echo separation. Then I'll want two additional sliders. I'll call one the wiggle rate and one the wiggle amount. I'd like to get my echo to move in the direction of this angle control by this separation amount, which means we need a coordinate that's the result of a vector and amplitude. So we're going to have to think back to some middle school geometry. But don't worry, I do this lots and I still have to look it up every time. Our first expression will live on the position channel of the echo, and here's what it'll entail. First, we'll define some variables using the PicWhip tool. A equals our echo control angle, B our echo separation amount. And now for math reasons, we need to convert these degrees here to radians. We'll make this calculation happen in the variable called D, where we will select the degrees to radians function of angle A. Then we need an x and y coordinate, so we'll put x equals the cosine of d times b, our amount, and y equals the sine of d times b. W will equal our wiggle amount, and r equals our wiggle rate. I've got a semicolon after each of these lines, all the way to the bottom, which means I can now put my actual calculation here. And it's really simple. It's just a coordinate, x, y, plus wiggle, r, by w. And look who's practically Neo now. This echo moves in the direction you say by the amount you want, and wiggles the amount you want once it's there. Now, all of these values are keyframeable, so you can really customize your look. Now, just like the last time, if you chose not to do variables, you could write that exact same expression using just pick whipping in long form. Like, for example, this is identical to this. But for your own sake, and especially if you're sharing the project with somebody else, I encourage using variables. What about color now? These shield echoes are all tinted kind of blue leaning. And sometimes there are reddish accents. So I think the best way to do this would be to add a color expression control to our control layer, and then a toner effect to our echo layer. Now we can simply pick whip this mid-tone color to be sourced from this control color. Pretty straightforward. We could also benefit from being able to blur these echoes just a bit. So let's add a slider control to our control layer. We'll rename it Blur Amount. And then we'll add a fast box blur to our echo. Now I can pick whip the blur amount to my expression controller. Only I'm going to add a divide by 10 to this. That way the slider control blurs in a more refined increment. Right about now I'm ready for those multiple echoes, like in my single frame example. And say I did duplicate this layer twice to have those two echoes. With some small tweaks to the expressions, I can tell echo 2 to multiply its offset amounts by 2, and echo 3 to multiply them by 3. And now as I slide up and down the echo separation, I get this cool spreading effect. It's a bit like chromatic aberration, but with controls and colors more specific to this movie. But wait, if I need multiple layers to create multiple echoes, it means I have 3 masks if I'm using them, and also if I find I need to tweak an expression, I'll have to dig through and figure that out among these 3 layers. And what if I wanted to do something like add chromatic aberration to give this effect a really cool, you know, bit of class? Well, now I've got 3 layers to mess with, and I can't exactly pre-comp because they're all connected to this control layer. And, you know, if you're fine with all that, you could totally finish these shots just like this. In a pinch, I'd probably just say, whatever, you know, that's the point of comping anyway. But I like the idea of reducing this effect to just one single effects layer. Now, is that possible? Well, I'm glad you asked, because I found a great solution using a utility from Red Giant Universe called Modes. Now, Modes is a super straightforward utility that allows you to mix 2 layers together using a blending mode of your choice. This is really designed if you're using a software like Avid that doesn't have native blending modes. But here in After Effects, I can hack it for this purpose specifically. I can apply a copy of Modes to a new black solid, and then here I'll select my footage layer. So by default, it's using an add blending mode to add in the video from my source layer. Since this solid is black, I just get a straightforward copy. And now we'll switch the blending mode of this layer itself to add. Now let's go ahead and draw a mask on this solid, just like when we were working with it as a video layer. If I twirl open the effect properties, under compositing options, I can add my mask to this layer by pressing plus right here. You'll see that up here in the effects window, a nice little icon to show you that the effect is using a mask appears right there. So what does this mean? Now, if we wanted to, we could go to distort, transform, or something like that, and say, you know, nudge the echo over. And check this out. If I had 2 copies of this right here, I'm just going to copy both those effects and then paste them below. Look at that. Modes is bringing in another copy of the layer, adding it here, and then transforming it again. And if I paste them again, or again, you get the idea. I'm going to stick with just 3 copies of these effects right now, and you can see that this black solid is now adding all 3 of these echoes right here. So I've got a very simple comp, one effects layer and my footage layer below. Now, I've been a bit sneaky, and down here I actually kept an old copy of that echo that we were adding all of these expressions to. And one of the cool things about the transform effect is that it has all of these same types of things. It's got a position, it's got an opacity, so I can hook up these old expressions to that. So let's go ahead and start by copying this position expression that we made earlier. I'm going to copy that. One little note, I'll admit that I forgot when I was setting up this fancy part of the comp to make my D equal degrees to radians A minus 90. I'm not sure why. I don't exactly know what I messed up, but definitely this is what will give you the right directional results later. Now, if I go up to my black solid, I'm going to delete these copies of this effect. And instead of having changed the position, let me just zero this back out again, and then Alt-click here, and then paste. So now with that expression pasted right here, I can go up to my controller layer, and everything should still be hooked up to it. So I can adjust my echo direction just like that. And my echo separation with the slider. So pretty cool. I'm going to dive in and copy over my opacity expression, also not to the layer's opacity, but to my transform effects opacity here by alt-clicking there and pasting this effect over here. And now my opacity should also be linked up to my controller slider right here. And it is. So that is great. With these two properties linked, now I no longer need my copies of the old expressions and I can just stick with these simple three layers. I also could now dive into my black solid, which is creating the echoes, so maybe I'll rename this layer Echo Effect. And I'm going to copy these two effects, keeping in mind that the transform has the expressions on it now. I'll copy those, paste them for a second copy, and then paste them one more time for a third copy. And if I dive to my controller layer, you'll see that, just as we would hope, all of the echoes are coming off of the echo direction and all controllable from here. Same as the opacity and the flicker rate, the flicker amount, the wiggle amount, etc. Everything is nicely hooked up, and it's all just this one layer. A few things that are missing are my color and blur settings, and just to show you how fast those would be to relink up, I'll go ahead and add a fast box blur and a CC toner effect here. And now I can do what we did before, where if I twirl open my box blur and my toner settings, I can also open up the blur amount and color controls from up here and do a little bit of linking this color to there and this blur amount to this. And if you'll recall, we added a divide by 10 just so we had some finer control on how much blur was happening. And there are those last two properties. Go ahead and unsolo that. And then on my controller layer, everything's working beautifully. So with this as the setup, it really means that I could have any piece of footage going into this layer 3 for clean. I'll alt swap that out, and you'll see that this effect could be used on any piece of footage. And this mask can be moved around to wherever you want the echo to be happening. I'm gonna go ahead and undo this for now just to get back to where we were. And now we have a nice controller layer that has all the properties that we want to be able to adjust with this effect. And we barely need to touch this layer except to mask the sections of footage that we'd like. Now, if you wanted to take things a step further, I highly recommend the Pseudo Effect Maker extension. It's available on AE Scripts, it is pretty affordable, and it gives you access to all the different types of effect controls we've been talking about, but allows you to stack them up within one effect. So for example, I could call this the Holtzman controls, and then basically mimic my setup of the types of effect controls that I've been using. Several sliders, an angle control, more sliders, a color control. And now for each one of these properties, I can rename them. And on top of that, I can designate slider minimum and maximum values, which is actually really helpful to allow you to know opacity should go between 0 and 100, for example. The flicker rate, we'll rename this one, can now have minimum and maximum values down here. And on top of that, you can also set default values for any of these. So the default opacity I could set to 100, and then I continue to do that exact same thing for all of these values, setting minimums, maximums, default values that I think will look good coming into the project. You'll see that I'm also able to group some of the effects together under a twirl down menu. All that takes me about 2 minutes. To swap this out, I'll go ahead and rename my original null to controller old. I'll add a new null object called the new controller, or just controller. And now I can apply my Holtzman control set here. And you can see it's just one nice effect now with all the top layer things I might want to adjust, like the opacity, echo color, echo direction, and separation right here. And then under advanced, I can adjust the blur, the flicker rate, the flicker amount, and all those things that you may not need to monkey with as much. So just a cleaner kind of look compared to this stack right here. So one option you can always consider going with, I'm going to use this going forward on this comp. I just have a little bit of replacing to do in the expressions themselves, but if I had set it up like this in the first place, this would already be done. And that's basically it. And now I'll go ahead and ditch my old controller and be just using this new controller now to control everything. I'll mention that one of the cool things about these pseudo effects is that they travel with the project file. So I could share this with anybody and they'll have this exact same effect here. No need to swap any other files aside from the project file. Now, all of the steps to create this template didn't actually take that long to set up. I mean, we're doing most of this in real time, and these, you know, 20 minutes or so will save us hours if we apply them to a cool fight scene. In the template overview video, I mentioned that once I applied this to the whole 30-second fight, it only took me about 45 minutes to step through, add some masks and keyframes, and get an amazing result. On a few select shots, I used Rotobrush 2 to give me a really nice edge and definition to some of these Holtzman Shield effects. Now, using the Holtzman Shield effect to demonstrate how to create expression control layers was completely arbitrary. You could link up any kind of effects to a control layer like this, and make them even slicker looking if you want to use something like the pseudo effects builder. The main advantage of having a template is that it allows you to iterate quickly, which allows your creativity to flow faster. Also, knowledge of things like this makes you a much more attractive candidate for leading teams and supervising more people on a project. And at the bare minimum, it saves you time. And your time is important. I respect your time. Thank you so much for coming to expression chats with me. You know what? I'm sorry.
Not sorry enough.
Links to the pseudo effects maker in the description. I'd love to hear about what kinds of things you guys hook up to expression controllers. So share that with me in the comments or find me on Twitter at ActionMovieKid.